time, Liz will bring you a microphone. Speak clearly into the microphone. Please let it be a short question, not a comment or a statement, but a question. And could you also please, I pray, say which of the women you'd like to answer the question, because, well, we'll see how it goes, but I may only allow one answer on that question.
Would any of the speakers like to speak about a potent technique that leads to silence?
Somebody's comment on the silence of death. I don't know, you'll have to choose for yourselves who like to answer.
One of the reflections that I have about the world in which we live now is that the noise we're making is because we're afraid of the silence of death. Death is an ultimate silence. It looks like an ultimate silence to us. And so sometimes I imagine that we're like people in a kind of in a forest and it's dark and there's kind of very scary creatures out there. And what we're doing is banging together dustbin lids and lighting fires, and we're trying to keep ourselves active and alive and awake because we want to keep whatever we're afraid of away from us. And it takes, again, a lot of courage to sit quietly in the dark. I think that, I mean, one of the most profound experiences when someone that we love dies is that their voice is silenced. And we kind of we yearn to hear their physical voice again. So I think that's partly why we avoid silence. I suppose that's my main answer to your question, because I think that when we become at peace with our own death, then we're more comfortable with physical silence. I think the two seem to me to be very clearly linked. And so part of the practice of silence will be when it's to become more at peace with the prospect of our own death. And when we are more at peace with the prospect of our own death, it seems to me that we'll be more alive than we are when we remain afraid. So it's another reason, I suspect, as far as to say to practice death, but to practice silence in order to become at peace with our own death.